Hi. In the previous lecture, we have studied about slip power recovery scheme basics. So now we are going to discuss about the static register. So as you can see, this is the circuit of static service drive. It is a setup for controlling the speed. And it is done in a wound rotor. That is why you can see here we have a rotor terminals taken out, and here we are having the resistance, and this is actually for bypass when this is for when you need a resistance control, then you can use this. That is why we are keeping a separate one. Actually, this is having an importance only when we need an external connection, and we are not using this setup for speed control. So, or okay. Anyway, here you can see in this setup now you are having a diode bridge rectifier, and here we are having an inverter, and here you are we are having a DC link inductor, and this inverter is connected back to the supply, three phase supply, through a transformer. So when we are coming to this, so VD1 is the DC link voltage, that is the output voltage of the bridge rectifier, and VD2 is the inverter voltage. So so here we are providing an LD, an inductor LD. This inductor is used to reduce the ripple. Actually, if you are using a diode bridge rectifier, it is a 6-pulse rectifier. So there will be ripples. To reduce that ripples, we are using an inductor here. So how we can control the speed using this setup? So before going to that, I have to compare with the rotor resistance control. In case of rotor resistance control, if you are using a resistive control, the whole power is lost in the resistance, but here the power which is in the rotor side, it is fed back to the three phase supply, or which is your input supply. So the total power will be reduced. That means the overall efficiency of the drive is increased. And in the previous lecture we have discussed about the power. So input power, the output power of the motor will be the difference between the input power and the power which is fed back to the source. This is true about the active power. And the what about reactive power? You will be having somewhat of reactive power absorbed by your induction motor, since it's a AC motor with a lot of coil. So there will be reactive power in this. Or you can see the in the equivalent circuit. Anyway, we are having impedances. So with this impedance, we will be having reactive power consumption in the induction motor. One more thing, we are having an inverter here. So inverter will also have certain amount of reactive power. So the total reactive power will be getting increased. So even when our active power is getting reduced and reactive power is getting increased, that means the overall power factor of the system will be reduced, or the system will run in a reduced power factor. So this is the basic of static service drive. This is a graph between torque and speed when we are changing the alpha. Alpha is the firing angle of the inverter. Actually, the firing angle varies from 90 between 90 to 180. Because for an inverter, anyway, our firing angle will be greater than 90. Then only it will work as an inverter. So this is the variation. When your alpha it is 90 degree, you will be having the maximum speed or the highest speed torque characteristics. Okay, so we will go to the base, the working principle and the mathematical modeling of the system. So actually, sorry, here I have shown VD1, it is actually VD2. So VD1, it is your DC link voltage, or after rectification, what is your voltage. Here S is the slip. So anyway, the EMF induced in the rotor will be S into V, where V is the input voltage. And N is the number of or a turns ratio of the motor. So we can say that VD1 is equal to 3 root 6 by pi into SV by N. This is your VD1, and it is a phase value of VD1. So VD2 it is your inverter voltage. So here you can see this VD2, this is mentioned here. This VD2 is equal to 3 root 6 by pi V by M cos alpha. The M is the turns ratio of the transformer which is connected here after the inverter and before the three-phase circuit. So if you are neglecting the drop across the inductor, this inductor that is your DC link inductor, so you can write like VD1 plus VD2 is equal to 0. If you are substituting the above equations, that is VD1 and VD2 here, then you will be getting 3 root 6 by pi into SV by N plus 3 root 6 by pi V by M cos alpha is equal to 0. Then this constants will come to the right side and will cancel out. So you can say that SV by N is equal to minus V by M cos alpha, and S you will be getting from this equation. If you substitute all this and rearrange that, then you will be getting S is equal to minus N by M cos alpha. It is equal to A cos alpha, where minus A cos alpha, here also minus is there, minus A cos alpha, where minus A is, A is N by M, where N is the turns ratio of motor and M is the turns ratio of the transformer which is connected to the inverter. That transformer is actually connected for equalizing VD1 and VD2. So the next slide. So we can see here VD2 is equal to 3 root 6 by pi V by M cos alpha. So maximum value of alpha is restricted to 165 for safe commutation of inverter thyristors. Okay, you can see here inverters. In this inverter, if you are connecting, if you are increasing the alpha more than 165, there is a chance of commutation failure, or I can say that if the these two switches are turned off simultaneously, then there will be a shock. That is called as commutation failure. So to avoid that commutation failure, we are keeping the maximum value of alpha to 165. So if you the slip can be controlled from 0 to 0.968 when alpha is changed from 90 to 165. This will be justified after we have been calculating all the things. So how we can justify this statement? So transformer is used to match the voltage VD1 and VD2 that I already have told you. So the what we have find, actually we have given M:1 is the turns ratio of the transformer. We have to find the turns ratio of transformer which is to be used for this purpose. That is our motive. So we are going to calculate all those things. So maximum value of VD1, so that is VD1M is equal to VS max by N. Since the variable quantity is S, that is why S max comes. Actually it is 3√6 by pi is here. So now I am not showing all the things, because anyway if you are substituting that in VD1 plus VD2 is equal to 0, that constant part will be taken out to the right side and it will getting cancelled. That is why I am not considering that. Where here this S max is the value of slip at the lower speed. Maximum slip means it is the value of slip at the lower speed. Whenever the motor speed is reducing, slip will increase. But we are considering an S max. Like when you are controlling a motor, you will be having a motive. Like you have to stop at certain speed. It is the minimum speed you require for this drive. So according to that, we will be deciding the S max, which is the lower speed you require. So if you are putting that, we will be getting VD2M plus VD1M is equal to V by M cos 165. This is the maximum value of F. So V by M cos 165 plus VS max by N. It is equal to 0. If you put that, then you can find the value of M from that equation. The value of M is equal to N cos 165 by S max is equal to minus 0.966 N by S max. This is why we have written here the slip can be controlled from 0 to 0.966 A. Can say that minus A cos alpha. Here S is equal to minus A cos alpha. Alpha we are considering it as maximum value of alpha we are considering it as 165. So if cos alpha is 165 means S is equal to minus A into cos alpha, that is minus 0.966 A. That also we can say that, that is why 0.966 A is the max we can control from control the slip from 0 to 0.966 A. So here you can see that M, the value of M, it is equal to minus 0.966 N by S max. So the turns ratio of the transformer is depending upon the turns ratio of the motor. If you have selected one motor for the drive, then N will be fixed. And S max is the slip, maximum slip, which can be determined from the lower speed required for the drive. That is a two criteria for selecting the M. Okay. That is what how we are finding the value M. So if you are considering the equivalent circuit of the motor, refer to the rotor. This one it is the equivalent circuit. Here we are not considering the magnetizing component. So you can see here S V by N. We have already taken that rotor side, stator side resistance and reactance to the rotor side. That is why S V by N is the voltage connected, and these are the resistance, stator resistance referred to the rotor, S R dash, S X dash, S X R and R R, and here is your V R. So if you are finding the equivalent circuit of the drive, then we are not considering the inductor, since we are dealing with a diode rectifier and a DC link. So if you are considering that with the DC of the drive, or if you are considering the circuit, equivalent circuit referred to the rotor, with the if you are finding the equivalent circuit of the drive with the refer to the motor rotor, then it is like this. So here when we found the resistance in the resistance control or static resistance control, if you are finding in the same way, you will be getting the resistance, that is S R, sorry, S R dash plus R R. It is the actual resistance when you have found, if you are finding in the same way that of the rotor resistance control, static rotor resistance control, then you will be getting S R dash plus R R dash, and if you are converting that referred to the DC link, then it will be 2 into S R dash plus R R, and this R T is the resistance of the DC link inductor. So now this is the equivalent circuit, it is not much important. If you want to find the ID is the current through the DC link. You can see in this figure, it is marked here. ID is the DC link inductor current, or the inductor which is used for the ripple reduction. The current through that inductor is ID. So, or you can say that it is the current passed through the inverter. So, if you are finding that ID, it will be equal to VD1 plus VD2 divided by, you can see it from here, VD2 is reverse, so that we are supplying this current back to the source. So you can see that if you are finding if you are going for finding ID, then it will be is equal to VD1 plus VD2 divided by 2 into SR dash plus RR plus RD is equal to 3 root 6 V into S by N plus cos alpha by N divided by 2 into SR dash plus RR plus RD. So if rotor power loss neglected, then you can say that your rotor power SPG is equal to VD2 into ID, since SPG is the rotor resistance power, and that rotor resistance, sorry, it is a rotor power that is fed back to the source. So you can say that this power we can represent with VD2 into ID, that is the inverter terminal voltage into the into current flowing to the inverter. That is why this is like this. So the PG, which is the motor output power, PG is equal to VD2 into ID divided by S. So if you want to find the torque, torque is equal to Pg divided by omega ms, and it is equal to Vd to Id divided by S omega ms. This is the torque. So these type of drives we are using that in the fan and pump drive, where we need narrow speed change, or you can say that the speed you have to vary not in a very large characteristic region, or you need to vary the speed in a very small range. Like if you are planning to change the speed from the synchronous speed to let it be 80% or 70% of the synchronous speed, in that range if you want to convert, then these type of drives are used. So you can see in chemical industry or production, some chemical production industries, there are a lot of fan drives which is used for fume control. That means some process is going on, then you want to change the fume, the amount of fumes inside a chamber. Then you will be increasing the speed of the fan or reducing the speed of the fan. Anyway, the reactions are going on for 24 hours. So you need to control the fumes, amount of fumes. So the fumes are getting more and more, then you have to push the air more and more, and it's in the normal fume production, then it will be about 70-80% of the speed. At that time you can use this type of static Schnabel drive. You can see one more thing, our the rotor power, it is SPG. And the transformer, the inverter and the transformer can be just this S max times of motor power rating. Like if you are finding the rating of that particular inverter or your this Schnabel drive mechanism, the power rating of that motor is very it's required in very very low, and the power rating should be much lower compared to any other drive, since it is because we are not controlling the speed from the main supply side. If you are going for the main supply side, then the whole drive should drive the whole power which is taken by the motor, and also it should have the installation capacity that is according to the voltage. The voltage is V. If you have given V, the voltage, the insulator should have the capacity to absorb the stress of that voltage. Also, current, also current will be very high because of that input current will be very high. If you are controlling from the rotor side with this type of drive, you can see the power which is coming to that controller, it is your rotor power, SPG. So you have a S max that we have already discussed how we have considering the S max. So the total power is S max into PG. The power requirement of the rotor side mechanism, it is according to the slip S max. And also the M that is also transformer rating. Transformer rating also will be same as that of the that means actually if you are thinking like if you need a 30% or 20% each, let it be 20% each is the maximum Smax, 20% of speed you have to control, 20% variation. That means you have to vary in the speed from maximum to the 80% of the origin value. That means your S maximum is 20%. That 20% if S max is 20%, then the power rating of all the inverter, rectifier and a transformer, it is just 20% of the power rating of the motor. So the drive force is considerably reduced since all the components are less power rating. The total cost also reduced. So already I have shown this here you are having a resistance. So the drive is started by the resistance control with this S1 is closed and S2 is opened. When the speed reaches within the control range of the drive, that is if you have 20% of slip is a maximum, then if you have reached that much of slip, then only we will be coming to the static shock drive. That at that time you will open the S1 and you will close the S2. So in fan and pump drives, the braking is not required. Since I already discussed, because of the fluid pressure provides adequate braking torque. So I already discussed how where we are using that. So we don't need to stop it sudden. So it will slowly come and it will come to standstill because of the fluid pressure. So there is a closed loop speed control that we will discuss in the next session.